been with OWASP for many, many, many years. He's one of the creators of SAMM. You'll find his name on almost every single project that OWASP has done. Another very famous thing that Dinis has done, his baby, is something called OWASP O2, which is a code review system and much more. It's basically a collection of tools for developers, which helps you find vulnerabilities in code. That was called Ounce Open originally, and then got renamed. Then IBM acquired Ounce Apps, and it becomes an app scan product. So it was very, very messy. But I think, well, a lot of it is Dinis's baby. And to be honest, the first time I saw Dinis, I think in 2007, I saw him presenting a talk, and I was absolutely gobsmacked when I saw him speaking. I said, oh my God, this guy cannot be real. It was just unbelievable what he was doing. And it's very interesting. So last year we went to AppSec Europe in Rome, right? And Dinis was presenting another one of his talks. Actually, he was presenting the same talk he presented here at OWASP exactly a year ago. And one of the guys in the audience who's never seen Dinis, he stood up for a question and said, you know what? I'm sweating just from listening from you. So because Dinis talks very, very quickly, but you'll understand absolutely everything. So he's going to talk to us about two important things, about summit that he's organizing this summer in June. And then he's going to talk about his SAMM product that he has built, and you can actually use it for visualizing your SAMM assessments. Okay, Dinis, it's all yours.
All right, thank you. Just a small correction, it's not just me. There's actually a really cool team and a whole bunch of guys.
Francois,
can you pop in there to your camera? Can you say hi? So,
yeah, hey guys.
Do you have a camera shared? I can't see your camera. All right. Oh, here you go.
Yeah, yeah, nice. Oh, yes, the front
so I was not here, but I'm actually trying to. Yeah.
I'm having the arm shift. I'm just looking at the
bell. All right, cool. So he's part of our team that are trying to set this up together, and then I'll leave you here, but then feel free to intersect at any time, Francois. So. This is actually going to be an interesting experience for me because I'm actually going to try to speak reasonably slow, and actually I don't actually have like zillions of slides, so I can actually slow down a little bit. So I want to talk about the OWASP Summit, which we're organizing in London. Well, just a bit outside London, right? It's a bit like the definition of the airport in London, right? As long as it's within that radius, it's called London, right? So I kind of want you guys to like close your eyes, right? Take a bit of a thing, right? And I want you guys to imagine, right, a place. Right, you can actually open your eyes, but imagine, right? Imagine a place where some of the best application security, minds come together to collaborate. Right, this place where we have a meeting of minds focusing on solving really, really hard problems. Right, it's not a conference; it's just this environment that we're creating. A place where security experts, developers, users, government agencies, vendors—they are all working together on shared goals. One of the nicest comments I heard about the previous ones we've done was this idea that it's like the UN, but it actually works. People actually collaborate. And it also, I think, represents the best of what we have in our industry. It represents people from every single tradition, religion, focus, whatever colors, whatever you have there. And they're all there because they're all geeks. They all care about application security. They're all very passionate about this. It's a place where you find like-minded individuals that care about what you care. So you go to the summit not because there's stuff in there that's interesting. You go to the summit because you're passionate about X. And OWASP is interesting because X is literally goes way, way wide, right? You go from people who like, Uber kind of stuff to guys who are really, really focused on various small things, to guys who focus on integration, to guys who focus on technology, etc. But you go there because you care about that. And that's the place where you're going to meet other like-minded individuals, right? It's the place where, it's designed for maximum geek time, right? It's designed for maximum synergies and collaborations, right? It's basically AppSec from 8 a.m. until 2 a.m. the next day, right? And it just keeps going, right? And it's designed like that. In fact, the first summer was funny because some of the guys, because we went to Portugal, they brought the families, and the families were really pissed off because the guys, realized, hey, I'm not going to spend time with you because actually all these guys are really here and I really want to spend time over there, right?
These are like Vegas gambling hours.
Well, yeah, exactly, right? But this is our geek time, right? And because it's kind of, in a way, this, right? You go to a conference, right? And the best part of the conference, right, it's not the presentation, right? Even tonight, although we are interesting as speakers, I bet that the most interesting part of the night is actually the people you've met, right? It's connections. But this is very unorganized. It's very ad hoc. There's a lot of amazing connections that could occur tonight that will not occur because you don't know who each ones are, and nobody here has been able to synergize you guys so you happen to be at the same time at the same location, and then you go, "Whoa, look, I really care about this, and you really care about this," and then magic occurs, right? So this place is actually also something that I actually think OWASP is one of the few organizations in the world that can actually do this. We are big enough, we are wide enough, we still have a really good open source and open culture, regardless of all the transitions and all the stuff. So it's quite interesting that we are one of the few organizations that can actually bring these people together. At the last summit, we had these guys that were spectacular. We had basically one representative, hardcore representative for each of the browsers. It was Chrome, Firefox, Opera, Safari, IE, and those guys were literally the key people on the browsers that they had written a book together, but they never met before. And we actually had the guys on the same stage, collaborating, figuring out how to build test suites, working on the next generation, stuff that you now already see in the browsers today. Some of it was actually created at one of our summits, right? So that's what you can create. Because actually, OWASP is at the center of application security, right? Basically, if you look at application security, in some way or form, everybody kind of is connected to OWASP in some ways, the companies. And I actually just add that, which I think is very cool, right? It's actually
collective wisdom of best minds.
I think that's a great way. I think that's what OWASP is, right? OWASP, it's not something that can create spectacular software. It's not something that can create best-in-class, in a way, products. There's, that takes a full company. OWASP is not that. OWASP is, this collective wisdom of the best minds. We bring research, we bring people together to solve problems, and that place is the OWASP Summit 2017, right? So there's the thing, there's the event, right? And that's basically when that particular magic will actually occur, right? So we got a website, which we need some help, if you guys want to help designing. It's actually built on Jekyll, and it's all driven by GitHub, so if you guys go to the GitHub website, it kind of automatically creates this. So please collaborate. So let's get to the details, right? So the main thing of the summit is the workshops. So these are the first pass at some of our workshops, and some of these are actually stuff that could only occur in this kind of summit. The other ones are some of our best projects, but what I want you guys to think is what you want to see there. So the way this works, and what we've done before, is between now and the summit, is everybody's going to throw ideas. So the number of workshops is going to kind of balloon, right? And we're going to make it organic so that the best ideas come on top. And then we're going to figure out which ideas have more momentum, which ones have more people. You might have some of the best minds in the world geeking on SSL. You actually have Ivan just around the corner, right? You probably can have some of the best guys actually figure out how we want to do a crazy SSL, and maybe for some coincidence, we might have a big concentration of guys who really care about that. We might have the next TLS meeting there, right? So suddenly, that means that you might have a bigger room, you might have more resources, you might have more stuff. Or maybe you have this very niche idea that only 10 people in the world actually care about, but guess what? 5 of them, or 6 of them, or the 10 are actually going to be there. So they can go into the meeting space and just solve problems. The point of this is to solve problems, is to create an ecosystem where we can actually deal with these problems and do something about it. So it's not just talk, it's about focus and getting the stuff done. So this is the last 2 summits we did, right? And you have to remember that what's amazing is everybody went there to work on collaborations and on security, right? These are all competitors and colleagues, and it's interesting, they came from all different places, right? But it's kind of like we all went in there to collaborate. And in fact, some of the guys you see here are actually now very, heavy hitters in our industry. It's also interesting to see the evolution of our industry, right? So again, and if you're the new generation, right, this is the place where you're going to meet all the key players, and I think we're going to make relationships, right? And these people come from all around the world, right? So, and I believe that if we could drag all these guys to Portugal, right, we'd be able to get a lot more crowd into the UK. Right? So we're going to host it at Woburn Forest, which is Center Parks. I don't know if you guys, anybody here been to a Center Parks in the UK? So this is actually very interesting because it's a new one, and it's also very together. I don't know if you've been to this one, probably not because it's quite new, but it's quite, a very interesting, well-run thing. And what they've done was they built this one very targeted for conferences. So not only the villas and the lodges are close together, they actually have really good conferencing facilities. So it's almost like the best both worlds. It's also very close to Bexley Park. So there's an interesting connection that we might want to do there, and it's literally half an hour, 25 minutes, half an hour from Euston or King's Cross, right? So again, it's pretty easy.
I see restaurants, private barbecues, and spa.
Exactly. Now we got the whole freaking thing, right?
Yeah,
like,
what would have been
Sorry? François, what was that?
Yeah, that was saying about all the barbers do and everything. It's just like the good thing about it is you get 60, 70 of the best minds in the world just working together and just making sure that we're just planning to do the best one.
And also that the way I look at it is that it's responsibility for from the kind of organization team is to make these environments very productive. So we actually had beer at 4 o'clock, right, just to kind of, you know, get things going. We actually, the concept of the lodges, which is this one, is that this is actually what makes the summit special, right? So what makes the summit special is that is the fact that we are not distributed in a hotel room and nobody knows where we are. Literally, we take these kind of lodges, right? And these are basically full-on, you know, massive places. In fact, this is basically the ones that actually have four bedrooms at the top, and then all the downstairs is where we have the meetings. And basically, this is where everything is happening. In fact, we're going to have meetings in here, but also after the main thing from 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, everybody aggregates in a couple, right? So, you know, in the last summers, we would take turns to basically, we would trash a villa at a time, right? You know, but then I know, actually, we might actually just reserve one just for a couple of things. But the point of this is that, you know, everything happens around here, so you have these great environments, right, where you can actually have all the meetings and all the stuff, right? So we already have 10 of these booked. Right, and that already means we're going to have 200 places reserved for the group, right? So the villas is actually key because that's where synergy and serendipity is created. The AppSec threads start at breakfast, continue doing the workshops, keep going to dinner, and go until late night, right? So literally, you are literally talking about AppSec and the stuff you care about, you know, all the time, right? And each one will have a different name, and we give maps to everybody. So again, if you want to have some privacy, you probably need to go, you know, to there's a hotel there too, right? So you can always go to the hotel, right? But the point of this is you go there to be found. You go there because you care about something, right? So it's quite an interesting environment, right? So we already have a nice participant list. Please, guys, keep adding your names to it. Please register, right? And here's just some quick workshop ideas. So we've got mobile security, for example. How can we deal with the mobile verification standard? How can we actually answer these questions? We have a testing guide, creating a hacking playground. So that would be like on a mobile security. And this can be from a session for a couple of hours or it can be like 2 days tracks, right? In a way, it depends on you guys. There's some interesting for next generation security scanners, how to actually improve the stuff. I know Sharif, which is somewhere, right? Here, but, you know, he's also quite keen on pushing a lot of stuff, and for that, right, he ran away. But again, this is a place again where, you know, we actually want the two vendors to come along. We want both the open source and the commercial ones. We want to work together. We want to figure out how can we take the tools to the next level, right? How to make it work? Because what I think is very interesting between 2017 and 2008 and 2011 is that the fast to summits was still very driven from the security industry. Right, like the number of real clients wasn't that big, and I think what happens is now the attackers have gone to another level. There's a lot of more of us, like me, for example, who actually are on the client. Like we're trying to protect this thing, right? And it's like, hey, I need the freaking tools to work, right? I actually need technology to really work. I need to scale because I need to do hundreds of threat models. I need to basically, you know, control thousands of developers, right? It's like it becomes real. Where I think, you know, in 2008, 2011, it was real only for certain companies, right? So I think there's a much bigger interesting of making this stuff work, right? There's also things like, for example, I think this is the kind of stuff where only at the summit we can probably get the people that are required to make this happen. So one of the giants, sleeping elephants that we have now is all these companies that basically are freaking giving GitHub access to all these third-party providers, which is lovely, it's great, the services, but that means that if one of them will be compromised, you're gonna have bazillions of public and private repos suddenly totally exposed. And this is a problem actually with GitHub and the other ones, and GitLab and all the other ones, because we haven't been able to put the three people together. We haven't been able to put GitHub, GitLab, all these online providers with the people that are providing the services, with the customers, i.e. with the guys who are actually using this thing and the security research, and going, hey, how can we make this work? Let's come up with a standard so that I can give somebody access to a particular codes in a way that I control, in a way that I'm happy to share that, so that I don't have to give them full access to my repos, for example. This is the kind of stuff that we can only do at the GitHub. Threat modeling, I think, is another giant one. You know, there's literally hundreds of people now around the world, or thousands hopefully, that are actually doing threat models, right? But the amount of information that exists is shocking. There's very few graphs, there's very few examples, there's everybody, it's still more art than science. What we really need to do is get these guys together and collaborate and come up with ideas, even show how each one is actually doing this stuff and push all this information out. So again, I think this is a perfect one. For example, one of the areas that I worry about, for example, is the actual diffing. How do you actually diff stuff? How do you actually scale this thing? How can I, you know, for example, figure out ways to actually see the difference between one threat model and another? You know, if I review the threat model, the next time I don't want to review the whole thing. I just want to see the thing that changed, right? Those are really hard problems. Or I like to do threat models by features and by layers, right? How to do that, how to share that. I think there's a lot of interesting stuff you can do. Like WebGoat, there's actually a WebGoat general because we have lots of WebGoats now. So again, you know, collaborate on that one, implement that stuff. And this is also a place where the people that use WebGoat can come along and actually share and talk with the guys who actually developing WebGoat and figure out how to do those things. And I think WebGoat has some great ideas on how to make it so that it doesn't look like a lesson, it actually just looks like a normal application and all sorts of stuff. So again, this is the kind of things you'll do. Now, actually, any comments or any ideas that you guys think that we should be addressing at the summit?
Comment also, please, somebody else.
I think secure development training is a big one for me.
Mm-hmm.
And specifically, how do you scale security development training if you're in a large organization,
yep,
where you know the effectiveness versus the cost benefit of in-person training versus CBT training? And probably this is something that Security Shepherd could solve,
mm-hmm,
but the last time I looked at it, it was in its infancy. So I suppose there's probably some,
yeah,
aspect of work to do there.
I agree.
But this is an interesting area for me specifically.
Yeah. And I think that's what I think is interesting on that is that needs to be driven by guys like you who have that problem, right? Who can say, well, that will scale, that will not scale, I'm the one who's going to have to push this out. And I think OWASP has a lot of those materials. What we haven't had was actually consolidation and almost like package them in ways that they can be consumed, right, by, you know, by teams and at the wider scale,
mm-hmm,
right? So yeah, absolutely.
Dennis, I'm impressed, seriously. I love the concept for a geek. By the way, it's nice to see you wearing shoes. For a geek, you really hit right on the money,
mm-hmm,
what it takes to actually create, which is the human interaction.
Yep.
You know, most technical people don't relate to that well enough.
Mm-hmm.
I think the mechanism, even putting them in dome style, it probably looks like better than domes, I think is an excellent idea. But let me just add a bit of sugarcoating on this.
Mm-hmm.
I think what you're doing is excellent. If there's any way we can help, happy to help. But there's something else that I think is worthwhile to consider. The model you're creating has, I see, two great values. One, yes, you create processes for what can be developed.
Mm-hmm.
But on top of that, what gets developed can be extrapolated and taken to emerging markets,
mm-hmm,
where technical people and very smart people do need guidance.
Yeah.
And if we can guide them, we make them part of the solution.
Yeah.
And I think this is also something we can help with. So I'm impressed. I like that.
Well, actually, one of my favorite comments from the first two summits were these guys who are these OWASP leaders, literally in emerging markets, right? I think the problem is when you're in London, when you're in New York, when you're in Seattle, in LA, you are in a bubble, right? You know the people, you know the community, you know the stuff. I had some great feedback from all these guys that come from, you know, from Africa. We had guys from Australia, we had some guys from Asia, and even guys from Greece. So when they came along, they're going, wow, now I get application security, now I see the community. And we made so many great relationships, right? And there's no coincidence that the number of chapters and the number of conferences exploded after that because you see those relationships. But I totally agree, right?
No, I mean, I get it. As a matter of fact, I think there's an opportunity there of developing new industries.
Oh, yeah.
In markets where, mm-hmm, some of these industries don't exist.
Yeah, so I want to bring them up. So one of the models that we want to do for the summit, and the idea of the summit is to break even, but because we actually want to use as much money as we can to bring people from other places. So last time we had a bit more funding from OWASP, so I was actually able to already promise that, but I hope that we're also going to be able to bring people, for example, from these other countries that maybe they don't have the money or it's hard to get sponsorship to come over. So for me, I view that one of our priorities is to get the most amount of talent into the summit as possible, regardless of where they are in the world. right? And I think that's where, as we get more sponsorship tickets, I want to make sure we get more and more funding to bring those guys on board, right? All right, so there's going to be two types of tickets for this thing. There is, and they all both cover the summit for the 5 days. So the idea is that, you know, we expect just about everybody to turn up the 5 days. There might be some exceptions. We'll deal with that, you know, with, you know, individually. But it's also to do with the scheduling, because the schedule is actually an art form, because it depends on the people, depends on who's there, depends on when he's there, depends on the sequence of events. So it actually helps that we actually have a bit of control of when people are going to be there. And that's why it helps. It's in the middle of a bit of nowhere, right? So you can't just bugger off, right, and go to town, right? So one ticket is for 5 days, 24-hour participants. So this is about £1,200. And that covers the venue, the lunch, the dinner, accommodation. So the idea is everything, right? So basically, once you're there, right, you know, there's no extra cost, right? Of course, there's always the bar, there's always the bowling, there's all the stuff you can do. But the idea is that, you know, you cover the venue, you cover the food, you cover the whole lot, right? And there's also like 5 days, you know, 8 participants, right? So 8 hours. So that's basically, you turn up for the day, you go up and you come down. Again, it's £400. So it's, again, you see that we actually kept the price reasonably low, right, for what it is, because we want to get... The idea of this is for you to bring a team, right? The idea is that you should go with you and your team and bring a bunch of people, right? Because we want to get as much talent as possible there, right? And that's the logic, right? And again, we eventually will make individual daily tickets available for the crowd. So there's also this idea of sponsorship. So you can get a platinum, gold, or silver sponsor. Actually, François is also very involved in the sponsorship parts. But you can see that the main part of this is that we're kind of pushing you guys to actually get tickets. Sort of like the idea is that if you're going to bring 7 people or 6 guys, girls, whatever, you know, to the venue, then you actually get a villa, right? And you get a villa, you get a lodge, you get your name associated with it, right? So, you know, you can basically have events there, you can have meetings there, and that's kind of where we also view some interesting opportunities, right? And then you can see it goes lower and lower, and then there's also some interesting things on drinks, entertainment, meals. They have some crazy stuff there too, so again, depends on what we can organize, what we can do. There's also interesting parts. So, the thing that we really want, right, for me, more than this, is to get people there. What I really want is to see this team, see the security champions, see basically the security team, see the developers actually going there and participating, right, into that thing, right? So we need your help, so that's down to you, right, because we have now secured the use of 10 lodges, so we have meeting rooms for about 20 participants, so we already have a summit for 200 people. So the reality is going to happen. Worst case scenario, we're going to use the lodges, right? And there's a meeting for 200 people, and it will be great, it will work, right? But we actually have today a whole other main conference venue, which will scale up to 500 people, and they have better meeting places, etc. But we actually need to really confirm by the 5th of February, right? So we really need you guys to actually see and give us an inclination if you can do it, what's happening. You know, there's some flexibility on the payments and all that jazz, but we kind of really need some commitment from you guys and the rest of the OWASP community. So I think now we're kind of ready to really push this out. So if you're planning to attend, book your ticket. There's actually an online website that we already have for this. You can deal with OWASP later. And then if your chapter has funds, please allocate them, chapter or project. So there's a lot of OWASP chapters I still have. Actually, very credited OWASP London, right? Because they were the first ones to actually sponsor us, right? So OWASP London actually has a villa there, right? I need to figure out what we're gonna do with it.
Yep, definitely.
So there's a good example of, you know, when your company chooses to donate your part of the funds to OWASP London, that's what they gave us the funds to actually push this out. So that's a good example of this. And we kind of need to get 25 to 40K ideally by that so we can actually get a lock on the venue. So that's actually a sort of a hard stop for us, because there's already 2 other people that are interested in that thing. So we kind of need that. So again, the key is we need workshop views and ideas, right? So if you don't see something you're there, please add your idea. You know, training I think is absolutely brilliant, right? We need to do it, right? If you're gonna lead the workshop, please take it. And it's actually the participants, right? So all the summits, all that we're doing from the summit organization is setting up the stage, is setting up the environment. It's actually up to you, it's up to the participants to create stuff, right? That's literally what we're trying to do, right? So we actually also wanna focus on this kind of intersection between developers, even CISOs, and also, you know, DevOps people, application security guys, C-level execs, everything. We kind of want to really bring these guys together, right? Because again, there is a great synergy that OWASP actually has the ability to bring them together, right? So we put them together, and also we want to work on real world problems, right? And that's why we want to bring these guys over there, right? So again, reach to these communities if you know them, talk to them, bring on board, because I think it's a great opportunity for everybody involved, right? So in conclusion, right, the place to be in 2017 is going to be the OWASP OWASP Summit. So the question is, are you guys going, right? Because I am. He's gone.
Yeah, I'm good.
So, any questions?
Was there no summit between 2011 and now?
No summits. This was the last notes in Portugal.
Yeah, not like this. There's been a couple, I would probably say, mini summits, projects at the OWASP conferences, but that model doesn't really work because you do need concentrated effort, right? So you know, there's been some good stuff that happened at the last major conferences, but summits like this, I think the only two that OWASP has produced with this level of people and focus have been those two. And happened in Portugal because A, I'm Portuguese, B, the guy that I was leading was in Portugal. So, and also for the, interesting enough, not being funny, but that was the only venue in the UK that we could find that had that environment. Because in a way, you need that villa model. You need the kind of environment where, you know, like if, for me, the picture that I have in my head was I remember being in the New York conference and going out for dinner actually with John Stevens, right? Which basically means I had a great time, I met some great peers, and I came back to the hotel and the room that we were sharing because a bunch of guys piling up, there was two amazing OWASP leaders watching TV, right? And I was thinking, and I had this mental picture of the hotel and all these guys there like slinker around and thinking, this is such a waste. Well, what a waste. All this talent traveled around the world, is in the same place, in the same freaking building, right? And these dudes are watching freaking TV, right? And you know, like, it's easy when you know the people. It's easy when you can just phone your mate and go, hey, what's going on? And there's a dinner over there. Actually, it was just six of us. Should have been 50 of us on that dinner, right? So for me, that's the beauty of the summit, is to get those guys together.
One suggestion. So at least you don't look like you're false advertising. Since you ask people to work from 8 a.m. to 2 a.m.,
yeah.
And part of the package is the spa facility, yeah. Guess what? They're not going to have time to go use the spa. At least allocate some hours in the day that they can go to the spa.
I know, yeah, absolutely. No, well, this is actually an interesting venue because they actually have all sorts of outdoors activities. It's actually a really cool circuit on the trees, you know, like the monkey thing. You know, they have Orlando, right? They have a go eight there. There's like, I think, you know, the paintball stuff. There's literally every kind of, a lot of, I think, sailing activities. So I think there's a lot of interesting stuff we can actually do as a group,
it's
right?
It's a bit of a working holiday.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. No, that's not
a working lunch, but this is a working holiday.
Oh, yeah. Well, but that's when magic occurs, right? Like, literally, you know, you might be playing football, but actually, that's where you create the bonds, right? You know, I'm a very big fan on those synergies.
Yeah, thank you very much for this. For me, it was my visit in the OWASP Summit 2011 in Portugal.
Right.
Yeah. So the best thing was the dynamic meeting. So is this, I mean, will we have a specific schedule or like that time was like, okay, we have a new idea, then with this, we have free time in this meeting.
Yeah.
So,
absolutely. Yeah. In fact, I have to say that this venue is actually better than the venue we use in Portugal, mm-hmm. because there's a lot more of those places. Mm-hmm. So one of the things we did, it was very funny, we literally went around the hotel, and every space that we could find with a couple of tables, we go, okay, this is meeting X, right? And put it on the map, we put a flip chart there, and then what he's talking about is that we had a global schedule, but we also said, anybody that wants to get together mm-hmm. and do something, there's all these spaces that you can book. So the reality is, this is actually better, because the villas are better set up, and they're literally very close. Mm. So literally, you can be in a conference facility, and the villa is actually less than 5 minutes away, not even that. Mm. So you can actually ping it back, and because I think that's when the magic occurs. The magic is when people go, oh, we really should talk about X. So yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Any more questions, guys? Okay, I think I can thank Dinis and move on to the next stop.
Yeah.
Sam.
Actually, Francois, want to say anything else? Sorry.
Yeah, Francois is online. You still online?
Oh, no, we lost
him. No, I think
he's still on?
I heard the blip.
Okay, oops. No. All right, okay. All right, so I want to talk about. Sorry?
Francois?
No, I think so. All right, so I want to talk about maturity models. Right, so who's actually using here a maturity model at the moment? Who's actually using either BSIMM or OpenSAMM? All right, so basically you guys are missing a trick, right, in terms of how you map and how you communicate your applications or even your security efforts, because I'm assuming everybody here cares about security, right? So maturity models are a great way to communicate security. It's a great way to measure security, and it's a great way to understand where your gaps are and what you should be focusing on, right? So there's two major, I think, software. Well, there's a couple of sort of really sort of convoluted and kind of hardcore, if you're into NIST and some of those big standards, right? I think there's a couple, you know, really heavy maturity models, but I would say in application, probably especially on application security side, there's two maturity models. There is the OpenSAM, which is this one here, and there is BSIMM, right? Which is this interesting proprietary but released with an open license kind of thing, which, you know, is basically driven by Cigital, right now acquired by
Nonsense.
There you go, those guys. And it's an interesting one, right? So I'll give you the lowdown on both, right? The OpenSAM is driven by a community, by OWASP. It was actually written by Praveer originally, for the guys who know Praveer Chandra, right? When working for Fortify, like there's some interesting stories there, right? And it's a view of, here's all the stuff that application security or security we're talking about, and here's how we position it, right? BSIMM took a bit of an interesting approach, where they interviewed a whole bunch of different companies. It was also a great way for Cigital to get contracts, right? Because it's a great way to meet those people, right? But again, fair on them because they got a lot of data, right? So it's an interesting one. I would say that you pick one, you know, and some are easy to sell than others. So you find whatever your CISO, whatever the guy who wants to lead it, where he inclines. If he wants to go more for the open part of the maturity model, or you want to go more for the kind of BSIMM and the data set. So BSIMM has better data at the moment. I hope we can change that. I hope the project I'm helping is going to change that. But, you know, it's a different model, right? The reality is that you should rewrite the questions anyway, right, to your culture. So, you know, it doesn't particularly matter as long as you keep the index the same, right, which is exactly what I did. So I had a problem, right, because I was hired for a company, right, to actually do a BSIMM mapping, right? And so that's why this thing supports both. And I was faced with a challenge, which is either I'm going to build a freaking Uber spreadsheet, right, which I didn't want to do, which basically will make me the main guy that will maintain it, make it very hard to scale, right? So it'd be great, but I don't like to leave that stuff behind, or I'll build a tool on top of something that exists. So I kind of chose the second option, right? So I build this, right? So what this is basically it's a web application that is actually exposes the BSIMM data, the SAMM data, the open SAMM data, it exposes both, right? So what it does is it has all the data mapped like this, so it kind of stored in JSON, so everything is stored in JSON. It's actually designed to use GitHub as a data store, right? Which is actually quite nice, and scales, and it's quite nice. And basically, the idea is you capture all the answers that the users provide, right? So if I show you the schema, the way it works, so the way both of them are mapped is they all mapped into this idea of domains, and then practices, and then activities. Right, so that's what SAMM looks like. If you want to see the BSIMM one, it basically looks like this. So you got BSIMM. And by the way, if you actually you can use it online, right? So you guys go to the IP address, you can actually use it now, right? And that's basically the.
Right. Can I just add? Obviously, quite difficult to write down this IP address, but if you go to the GitHub, OWASP, it's actually on README.
Yeah.
Okay,
exactly.
So can you just show it on the...
Yeah, so if you go to the maturity models, right, in fact, okay, so even better, so if you want to find it, you go to OWASP, GitHub, right, and then you search for
maturity models,
right, that one, right, and then in here...
That's the IP address.
Yeah. It's actually pretty cool if you guys want to, if you want to continuous deployment and continuous integration, that thing is actually, it's the Docker image that is automatically built once all my unit tests and integration tests pass, which then goes to Docker Hub, who then is deployed to DigitalOcean, who then deploys into the Docker Composer thing, which is actually quite nice.
Full use of the cloud.
Exactly, right? And by the way, this thing has 100% code coverage, right? It goes about, depends on the sprint, right? But it goes about that, right? So here's the schema, right? So you can see that you have the governance, you got the intelligence, STL touchpoints, and deployment.
So can you show us one more time the source code for this? Because the source code is JSON, so it's rendered as a spreadsheet, but it's not a spreadsheet.
Yeah. So basically, if you go into the... Actually, there you go.
GitHub point. Probably the best place.
Yeah, if you go to GitHub. So if I go into... sorry. some maturity models. So this is actually using submodules, which I highly recommend you guys to do. A lot of devs freak out with GitHub submodules. I think they're brilliant, right? And they really allow a nice segmentation of stuff. So if you go into the code, you'll see there's a different submodule for the API, the UI, and the QA stuff. If you go into the data, right, you'll see that there is the BSIMM and the OWASP. So what you actually do in your company is you take a fork of this and you add to here your private repos, right? So what I have in a couple of companies I've done this is they have a fork of the main basically submodule links, which is this guy here, and in here we actually link into the private repositories that actually contain that data. So that was a great, nice way to keep everything separated, works really well, right? And then here, so if you go, for example, to OWASP SAMM, you could see the schema, right, which is there, right? Again, that is actually just nice, right? There's a schema.
Yeah, so that's the spreadsheet.
That's the spreadsheet just there.
Nice format.
Yeah, and then you got the freaking details, which, you know, again, is maintained. There you go, right? That's all the details, right?
So instead of creating it as an unscalable Excel spreadsheet,
yes,
it's scalable JSON.
Absolutely. That's, there you go. That's
in the cloud.
That's a good definition.
And it looks really good.
Well, it's Dockerized. It doesn't necessarily need to be in the cloud, right? It's Dockerized, so you can actually deploy it locally, deploy a thing. So usually, to give you an idea, this is maintained by the security champions, right? So the security champions are the ones who actually maintain the individual mappings, right? And they actually take responsibility for that, and I'll show you some of the things in play. So this is kind of the domains, the practices, the key activities. The thing that is, first of all, very interesting is how you enter data. Right? So for example, you come in here, you can create a new team, right? So you get to see that there's your score, which I'll come back in a second, and now you have a couple of ways to enter data. You can enter data like this, right? And this actually has a couple of interesting ways to look at the data. So you can basically first just see them like that stuff, where you get the key, the activity, and the yes, no, and all that jazz. You can actually then, for example, add domain and practice, if you want, right? And then you can actually see, so, This prints really quite well. So actually, usually I actually start this with a printed version. I literally print this out and go blah, 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 blah. And it's always very interesting, the difference between the architects and the business owners and developers, because the developers go, no, 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 no idea, fucking hell, shit, no. The security guys go, well, no, no, no. The architect, yeah, absolutely, we're doing all this stuff, right? that doesn't really work, right? So in fact, what you need to do, which is exactly what we did, right? So, and I recommend you guys to do it, is you basically take a look at all these questions, right? You rewrite this thing and you change the levels, right? So the logic of this is level one should be something that everybody does, right? Should be like your baseline, you know? So it shouldn't be something that, you know, is wishful thinking, shouldn't be something that is very hard to do. Your level one, right, which are all the ones, or you can actually see the level here if you want, level, right, you can see the levels there. All the level one stuff, right, should be what every team should do, right? So this, in my view, this is different for every organization, because every organization will be at a different level of maturity, right? And I even think that service providers should be selling this, because you should actually be also using this to see how your customers are doing, and you can even compare that to the other customers and say, this is the gaps that we have, and these are the gaps that exist in the market. Right? So you should rewrite this, right? So one of the things that I've added here was also the ability to see the objective, which is quite nice. There's also the description, which is also quite nice. There's also like the description is also here. And again, please give me, you know, feedback on the UI. A lot of these things are literally the, you know, come back of going, I really want to see this, but I don't want to see the other one because it's too big, because I want to see them in one line. So a lot of this is literally direct feedback of people using it. So again, you know, please give me some feedback on how it's done. And then you can basically start adding the stuff. So you can either do it here. So this is usually where you actually, you know, provide information and then you save it. There's also a table. So if you actually have done this manually, it might be easier to fill it here, right? And also you get a nice sense for the different things. So that's a different way of slicing information, right? And then once this thing is actually saved, right, and you actually load that, you can actually see the information on the radar, right? And the radar is very interesting. So let me show you how you read the radar, right? The way you read this is, let me pick, I think, a better one, is like this, right? So that's, so basically each one of these represents one of the kind of practices, right, of this. So you can see kind of where you are. So the nice thing of the maturity models, it gives you a path, it gives you a way to understand where you are. And the magic is that you control the questions, right? So the nice thing of this is you can actually social engineer your company or your client to do the right thing, because you can actually control the freaking questions, right? So you can actually guide them to specific things and ask them questions that actually make sense, right? Well, and sometimes when you have hard teams, you can actually have questions that are designed to expose gaps in those teams, right? Because they might say, yeah, we do everything, we know how to do everything. We go, fine, let me measure your maturity, because this is how you should be doing stuff, right? So there's some interesting elements here. Remember that it's already a political game. This is just a way to play nicely, right, and objectively. So the way you read this, which is very interesting, is if you look at this guy here, for example, you see, so that's level one, that's level two, that's level three, right? So that's what you aim at. So what you have here is something which is quite typical, is instead of doing everything, for example, on level one, the teams start to cherry pick the stuff that is easy for them. So this might be they have a lot of TA, which basically is test assessment, whatever, right? And they have a lot, actually this is wrong, I don't know. This should be a TA there, right? Or one of these guys, right? And basically, you have a couple of these guys here, but they should be doing the other ones, right? So I think the TMF is a better example, and I think I know the problem. This guy is actually, there's a bug here, okay, sorry. And so if you look at TMF, so that is another good example of a team that has already done a lot of stuff, but they have gaps, right? And then, so the nice thing of this is that you start to get a sense for where are the gaps across the board, and you start to get a sense, that's interesting, right? And you start to get a feel for stuff. So again, that's actually something I've seen, which is, again, you have some teams that are already doing a lot of technical assessment. It's actually technical assessment. Very mature, so it's almost like they're level three almost, but they haven't even done some of the other stuff before, right? So that is actually quite nice. And you start to see gaps across the board. So one of the nicest things is to have the scores, right? So the scores are also interesting, because when you see something like this, this is a problem, right? Because this is a team that is doing a lot of stuff on other levels before it even completed the previous levels, right? So what you really want to see is 100%, 90%, and then 70, maybe 15, right? And that might mean that your levels are wrong. It might be that in your organization, if that's systemic, means you should move a lot of stuff to level one and some stuff to level two, because it should be kind of an evolution into it. Another really great view is the observed one, right? So I'll show you how to read this. So this is basically when you have a heat map on what is actually being used on the organization, right? And the way you read this is if you look at level one, you see that actually we're doing some great stuff here. For example, where we have these gaps already. So if you see the reds is the stuff that nobody is actually doing. For example, very few teams are doing. So this becomes very interesting, because it means that you can now figure out what it is, and you can come up with a strategy for addressing those issues. So this is actually quite nice, because it shows you the gaps on what actually going on the environment. And then if you see things like level two, you see the stuff you're doing, and then you might argue, why is everybody already doing this guy, right? Where they haven't actually finished the other ones. And one of the things I've added here was, you can click off any of these, and you can actually see the explanation, but you can actually see which team are doing it and which team is not doing it. And this is one of the things I've added, was the ability to add proof, right? So one of the things that I found very important is that when you actually have something like this, it's actually really, really important to actually be able to enter, right, a proof into the application. So it's very key that you actually are able to say, let me take the activity or the, if I take away the objective, right? So this is very interesting, because this is where you say, actually, where is the proof? So the way we got this was the idea of, what is the definition of yes? So once somebody says yes, how do we measure? And that's an area that I really want to work next. So what I want is to be able to start to do this automatically. I want to be able to have a programmatic way to start to check. When somebody says yes, we should say, okay, cool, where's the link? Where? How can I check that is actually done?
That's actually a very important concept. So proof is a URL.
Absolutely.
Okay, and you talk about this. So if it doesn't have a URL, there is no proof.
Absolutely. Because it has to be measurable, right? Now, the very interesting thing that when I started doing this, and I was working in an organization that had a really mature sort of risk model and even threat assessment, the guy was there saying, yeah, but what's great about this is you have proof, because my world is faith-based security, right? I ask all these questions, I get all this stuff, and people say, yes, yeah, yeah, we do all these things, right? But there is no proof. There's no real evidence of what is actually happening. So I think this allows you to tackle that problem in two ways. Allows you to rewrite the questions. So, and I would say, just as long as it's kind of around this, you can actually use the ideas, because it's quite a nice way to link it back among different things, but allows you to control the temperature on this, and then the proof is where it gets very interesting. And then I really like this view, which doesn't look very well here because you don't have real data, but this is my favorite view, because this is where I can read the stuff, read the information, but then see exactly what people are proving it, and even I can get the stuff when they say no, or they say not. We add the DNA there, which is not applicable, which is always a very interesting discussion, say, why is that not applicable to your environment?
Yep. I noticed that one of the points was identify attack surface or something like that.
Yep.
So if they say yes, I've done that, and here's a document, right?
Yep.
Here's a document that shows I've identified attack surface. You don't really know that they've identified the attack surface. They've identified some extent of an attack surface, perhaps,
yep.
but to really verify that, you've got to get into the guts of it, and that's going to be very time consuming, and that's one checkpoint or whatever.
But that's the responsibility of the security champion. So this is designed so that this is mapped to the kind of security champion network, or the idea that every team or every group should have a person that has 20% of their time that is dedicated to security or AppSec. So they are the ones that maintain this.
Yeah. And just a follow up,
yep.
So unrelated, but is the ASVS like a subset of this in any way, or is it completely exclusive?
No, so the ASVS is, and we actually should link to this, right? And if there was a mapping, I probably could have used it. So the ASVS, so it's Application Security Verification Standard, another project for us, allows you to zoom in, right? So one of the things that I would like to see more ASVS, and again, the summit would be a great place to work on this, is to actually map it to tests, map it to integration tests. So we can actually say, for example, the attack surface is something that is on the ASVS. Right? But that's the problem. You see, the interesting about this is my next generation I'm already working on is actually, you actually need maturity models inside maturity models. Right? So it actually means that a lot of these questions actually need a maturity model itself. Right? So even like security champions or even attack surface are great examples. Right? It's not just about having it. Is it working? Is it true? Can you check it? Does it feed another tool? Right? The problem is, in most organizations, it's already You barely can actually get yes and no's for learning stuff, but I think that the real interesting part is when you zoom in into the specific ones. So you can actually have partial values, which is a feature that we're going to add soon, but also you have maturity models inside of it. So it's almost like the result of that feeds this guy here, which is why I like the idea that you're doing this in JSON, you're doing this in this environment, because those things are not that complex. Where this was a spreadsheet, this is when the spreadsheet would start to go crazy, right? But I think the attack surface is a great point, right? And I think that's exactly, you see, one of the items I add to my Jira workflow just about everywhere is we don't know the attack surface, right? Because the attack surface needs to be programmatically calculated, or else it's a pointless exercise.
Just a quick question, because
yep.
I'm very much I'm a kind of a technical engineer,
yeah.
And when I've previously helped large banks be able to map technical controls to these kind of statements. Do you see this application being able to map out like technical controls, like a GPO setting, and being able to automatically go and check and then report back into the system?
Well, first of all, so this is generic, right? So basically, if you change the schema, you can ask whatever you want there.
No,
right?
But what I was thinking was if you set a particular question,
yeah.
And then you could map a technical control against that question.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of engineers,
yeah.
Won't understand, you know, security guys are really good at coming up with woolly and woolly questions,
yeah.
That technical guys don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
And the better way of doing it is maybe to have like a technical question and then say, right, this is an example of how you should be securing it, and then maybe have the system be able to automatically check the system.
So by the way, the way this is kind of done is that we actually have, there's some interesting stuff in here in terms of the development. So if you actually go into the maturity models, you get to see the issues. So it has a reasonably high number of issues because I take the view that I document everything, actually using the GitHub projects, which is actually quite cool, right, to map this stuff here, right, actually using all sorts of tags to the thing. So one of the issues that we had here, one of the ideas that we already looked at is exactly a variation of that, is how do we actually, let me see if I can find it with merge, but how can we actually connect issues, right, together, right? So basically one of the issues here is that how can we actually map, you know, specific, even different BSIMs, but also, you know, so kind of connect stuff, right, to each other, which is exactly that point,
yeah.
Right? And that's why the proof is so important. So the area that I'm in now is I've deployed this, we got the data, I'm now focusing on that definition of yes, right? And which is at the moment, I'm still getting to the point where I'm focusing on actually getting the answers kind of here. That's why there's actually yes answers, right? So I can print this out and just get the guys to focus on what they said yes. For me, the next interesting part is building connectors to this. So the idea that we know that this should be on a Jira ticket, we know that this should be on a Confluence space, we know that this should be somewhere, because that's the definition of that particular thing. And that's why I think it's important to start this, knowing that you need to rewrite the questions to make them real. So the kind of, the ones, it's a shame that I cannot share the one I created because it was quite nice, but it gets company specific very fast. Because you rewrite it using their words. You rewrite using what they call that, right? So that's why I think what's key is the activity keys that you can actually connect the dots, right? So you can still bring them across companies or across groups.
So you said the schema is flexible.
Yeah.
Could you use that as an ASVS import to map them in a maturity model as well?
Yeah.
I think that's on the box, and then the URL could point to a test or a file or whatever.
Absolutely. I think that, well, hey, this is open source, right?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
And actually, so I can show you this thing here, right? So, okay, so basically I was just checking it out, and you see that this is my test coverage, right? And you can see it's the 99.82, right? And the nice thing of 100% code coverage is these things now become the real thing, because you go, why? What's going on? Why am I not checking that, right? So I can actually show you where it is, it's gonna be here, right? And it's actually, that little dude, this is CoffeeScript, right? It's that guy there, right? So I can actually take a look at it. So I can actually open it up in WebStorm, which is here, right? So this is kind of my environment. And remember when I talked about in the past, you need real-time code coverage and execution, right? So this is what it looks like. You can see that if I come in here and I change that, right, I expect my test to break, right, in real time, right? If I go and I change actual methods, right, which is this guy here, right? So if I make it, can I make it a bit bigger? Come on. Okay, cool. So if I change, for example, this method so it doesn't return null, it returns something else, right, I should get straight away an error, that a thing that changed. You cannot underestimate how powerful that is. I change in the code and I get a list of every single unit test that actually broke or integration test is actually failing because of this moment, right? So in this particular example, and this is actually something which is interesting, right, is that when I looked at what was missing, right, so if you go here and I see what was missing, which is this guy here, right, and again, from a development, a little kind of detour on development land, right, I'm actually having this project schema details method, right, which at the moment I'm checking the values, but I'm not checking if the project is null, actually returns something. What is interesting is in this particular case, I actually didn't have a specific test for that, because if I look at this, I see that, you guys probably can see that, but I'm actually testing that from the API project and from the API create Angular service. So the way I look at it is that I really don't like small unit tests because they tend to be pointless. I prefer tests that invoke a lot of stuff. So in this particular API, this is already used by another test that I use somewhere else, so it already gives me good coverage. Amazing. I don't specifically need to test this guy exactly. I can actually just test his behavior somewhere else. And it's going there. So in this case, all I have to do to finish this off is just basically add these guys here, and you can see in real time that guy has run, that executed, and we're back to 100%, right? And I think that's where it should be, right? And it should also be, from a point of view, especially when we talk about integration tests, you want to make sure that you're hitting that degree of code coverage,
right?
There's the proof,
100%
right?
Code coverage?
Yeah, uh-huh.
That's the proof.
But also what's absolutely key is that you have the ability to write tests for bugs. So if you go into here, you see that I have security tests, right? I have tests that confirm that the security issues that application has are actually features, right? And then if you actually go to the website and GitHub, you can actually go to this label called risk. So if you go to the labels here, there's a label called risk accepted, right? So if you go there, right, and you can click on this label, right, and you can see these are all the vulnerabilities by design that the application has, right? So this is exactly what I defend when I do my AppSec stuff, is I get worried if you guys can find a vulnerability on this application that is not mapped here, right? Because this is the current state of affairs of the application. So my worry is if there's a blind spot, if there's a risk or a vulnerability that I don't know about. So if, for example, somebody says, hey, we really would like to put this on more enterprise or productize or put it on the web or do some stuff, I go, actually, maybe we should add some things. Maybe we should add some more better threat models. Maybe we should add some security, etc., right? Proper things. So the way I look at it is that every time I find or I do an analysis and I understand something, I add it here. If I don't have the time or it's not the right time to fix it, I accept the risk because it has to be mapped. These are all features of the application, right?
And may I remind you, this is all fully open source and available on GitHub.
Yep. So it's there, right?
So don't take pictures of the screen. You can just navigate to GitHub.
Yeah, you can go there. So the best screen on this is actually this guy here, right? Actually, this is another really nice one, where you can actually, again, see which teams are doing yes, which teams are no, which teams are maybe, which ones are NA, for each one of these guys. So again, it's quite, and yes, there's a bit of a gamification, there's a bit of a competition, but that's the point, right? The point is to start to identify which teams are not doing X, so that you can focus on it, right? And you can help them, and you can basically create a strategy. Because if everybody's not doing something, then that is actually not a problem with that team, right? It's a problem with your current support, your infrastructure, whatever. So actually, one more comment. The other thing I've done was I removed, especially on the first phase of this, everything that the central security team should be doing, right? So, because you actually need to control the questions, right? You freak them out if you turn up with more than 40 or 60 questions, right? So ideally, you have 20 questions per layer, and they should all be focused in the beginning on the things that the teams that you're interacting with should do something about it. So to go to them and say, do you do a global policy for vendors, or do you have an intrusion detection system across the board? You don't ask those guys this, right? You literally ask only questions. So that's one of the things I would say about the current version of OpenSAM is, and BSIMM has the same problem, it's too big, right? We actually need to create slices, which are some focus on the SOC crowd, some focus on the security team, some focus on the actual individual teams, and even their maturity. Sometimes it doesn't make sense.
Visualize the data. And I think in my view it is. Well, this tool allows you to do this, allows you to visualize those maturity models like nothing else. Because if you actually open the PDF documents for both BSIMM and SAMM, you'll find it really, really tricky to use because they've actually been prepared for print. Right, the PDF files, you can print them to a book, and you can go through it as a book, but actually use it for that kind of thing. You see, there's a, how useful, well, what can you do with this kind of stuff, right? It says this is your level 1, level 2, level 3, and there is some text there, and says that's your objective, that your activities. It just, to me, just printed piece of paper, which I can't do anything, right?
Now what?
So what this has done is that, okay, I'm going to copy and paste it all into a massive JSON array, so it's usable,
yeah.
And then now I can present it as a spider chart, I can present it as a spreadsheet, and I can present it as a set of interactive questions and say, yes, are you doing it? No, you're not doing it, or I'm not sure I'm doing it, and if yes, you're doing it, what's your definition of yes? Give me the proof, give me the URL, where is the wiki, which shows you're doing it, where is the directory on SharePoint server, which has a list of all the penetration test results, if you are saying you're doing pen testing of all your apps.
Yeah.
That's where the value is. This standard, right, is a great thing, but on paper, it just says a paper standard, right? And this is because Dinis basically has digitized it and opened it to the whole world, made it open source. Okay, guys, I'm afraid we're running out of time because it's 9 o'clock. I have time for one more question.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a point that straight away I see this solving one of my problems, which is that trying to specify NFRs, so
yeah.
Non-functional requirements, because that way you can easily, so going away from a massive spreadsheet, you can actually easily see your progress as you're progressing through the various sprints
yeah.
into which of those NFRs are being met.
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
And that's what I like about maturity models. For me, the click for maturity models was it allows you to apply pressure where pressure needs to exist. So one of the things that's also actually that it's needed here, but I really have not the need for that yet, but is you also need to start mapping better which teams need to be up with level. So what, one of the things already done in a couple of places where, for example, you say, well, these four teams can be on level 1, and these five teams can be on level 2, and actually these four teams have to be on level 3 because of the assets that they touch, because of where they sit on the organization. So ideally also the graphs should relate that. So in a way, we actually stop putting things in red for these guys after level 1. right? And but for these guys, we actually want to really put pressure on, right? Because they're touching the assets. And that's sometimes the game. The game is, oh, you want to do, you know, this thing, you want to connect this, you want to use that application, you want to use that asset, you want to, you know, does your application needs to have these features, then guess what? This is the game that you're going to have to play because you need to be doing all this stuff.
Right. Okay. Thanks so much, Dennis. Yeah, let's thank this for that. Before we finish, right, we'll show you just one more slide or two more slides. Right. So the main thing to say is thank you very much for coming here. Right. And it's been a fantastic turnout. Right. Let me just... Okay. So, just a quick reminder that you can keep in touch with us on Twitter, Facebook. Don't forget to watch us on YouTube. Right, they saved the date of the future meeting last Thursday of March in 2 months' time. We don't know the venue yet, but if you can provide a venue like this, this is really nice, and it's probably the best venue we had in the past year. Yeah, please do. Please talk to us. Okay, call for speakers. Okay. You see, we have two fantastic speakers, right? But actually, originally, I only had one, and I had David. So Dinis had to step in at the last minute and said, hey, Sam, you're running out of speakers? Oh, I can present OpenSAM. I can present this. And OK, thank you. So I like Dinis a lot, but I don't like using it as a scapegoat for the last minute talks. So please, if you have something to talk about related to application security, please come forward. Please contact us. Please email us. And we'll see if we can arrange your talk and schedule it for one of the future events. Just email us, owasplondon@owasp.org. We have three main tracks, so breakers, anything about breaking stuff. So tonight's first talk was about breaking stuff, okay? We also have a track on defenders. We haven't had anything about defense today. And we're the builders. So Dinis's talk was about builders because he built a fantastic tool which is free and open for everyone to use. So if you can present a talk on any of these three tracks, please do contact us. So last thing, I would like to thank our speakers, David, Dinis, Francois on Skype, and Seva couldn't join us. And host for this event, JP Morgan Chase, thank you very much for hosting us. Usually I have a picture of a pub on this last slide. And I'm a bit stumbled because I have no idea where to go. So. Guys from JP Morgan, where do you usually go after work for drinks? is that a nice place?
The Hack and Hop, but it's a bit small. Depends how many people.
I don't think we'll fit there. I saw that pub.
Yeah, it's quite small.
Black Rice Arms across the world?
Yeah, it's close, it's obvious. Fine, yeah, cool.
Okay, is it good? It's good. Okay.
Yeah,
I'll say all that. Thank you very much, everyone, and hopefully we'll see you at the last minute.
I'm just going to mention to you the ML shipping for threat models.
Yeah.
And then I saw picked up on the road.
Yeah. That's what it is. Yeah. Ledger ML for RAP.
Yeah.